I got to put it up here and it'll reverberate, but that's okay. We're going to do Come and Dine. Jesus has a table spread where the saints of God are fed. He invites his chosen people, come and dine. With his manna he doth feed and supplies our every need. Oh, to sit to sup, could you sing with me, would you? Come and dine, the master calls, come and dine. You may feast at Jesus' table all the time. He who fed the multitude turned the water into wine. To the hungry calleth now, come and dine.
Yeah. Who am I that a king would bleed and die for? Who am I that he would say and pray, not my will, thine for? Who am I?
When I think of how he came so far from glory, came and dwelt among the lowly, such as I, to suffer shame and such disgrace, on Mount Calvary take my place, then I ask myself, who am I? Who am I that a king would bleed and die for? Who am I that he would pray, not my will, thine for? The answer I may never know, why he ever loved me so, that to that old rugged cross he'd go, for who am I?
Then I'm reminded of his word, he'll leave you never.
If you'll be true, I'll give to you the life forever. I wonder what I could have done to deserve God's only Son, to fight my battle still there won. Who am I? Who am I that a king would bleed and die for? Who am I that he would pray, not my will, thine for? The answer I may never know, why he ever loved me so, that to an old rugged cross he'd go. Who am I? Who am I that a king would lead and for? Who am I that he would pray, not my will, thine for? The answer I may never know, why he ever loved me so, that to an old rugged cross he'd go. That to an old rugged cross he'd go.
Thank you. That was awesome. If you have your Bible tonight, turn to John chapter 6, if you will, please, tonight. John chapter 6. Are you glad you're saved tonight?
Amen.
I'm glad I'm saved. I'm glad I'm serving God. I don't know of anything else I'd rather do than to serve God. And I'm so excited to be here tonight, and thanks, Brother Grimes, for asking me to preach. I missed Brother Anderson this morning. I was very busy over there with the children this morning, so I didn't get to see him, and I know y'all probably had a good service over here with Dr. Anderson. John chapter 6, us preachers, we like to have a catchy title for our sermon. I don't do that all the time, but the Lord gave me a kind of a catchy title to this sermon. It's called Saving the Leftovers. How many of you likes leftovers? Now, some things are really good when they're leftover. Leftover pizza. To me, the two things that are really good leftover are spaghetti. I don't know what it is about spaghetti. It ferments or something, you know, like 2 days later. And something happens to it. It just makes it better. You know what I'm talking about? And the other thing, which I had for lunch today, is one of my favorite dishes is chicken and rice. And I don't know, it does the same thing. The next 2 days, I can eat it for like 3 or 4 days. I just love it. But there's some things that are good that are left over. There's some things that are not so good, like spinach left over, you know, asparagus tips, you know. You with me, guys, on this? Now, pizza's pretty good leftover. My wife, she's a little weird. And if you were here this morning, you saw the weirdness of her life. But I said, "Aren't you going to church?" She said, "No." And she always says the same thing. "I'm not going tonight. I'm going to sit here with Heather because he's really hurting." And she said, "I've heard it all anyway." I said, "Thanks for the encouragement." You know? But she, one of her leftover things I remember for years and years is cold pizza out of the refrigerator for breakfast. Now, I can't do that. I mean, that's just, you know, she does that, but I don't do that. But save the leftovers. Sometimes it's a good thing. And in John chapter 6, it is a good thing. And so I want you to read with me in John chapter 6, starting in verse number 4, if you will. "After these things, Jesus went over the Sea of Galilee, which is the Sea of Tiberias, and a great multitude followed him because they saw his miracles, which he did on them that were diseased. And Jesus went up into the mountain, and there he sat with his disciples. And the Passover, a feast of the Jews, was nigh. When Jesus then lifted up his eyes and saw a great company come unto him, he saith unto Philip, When shall we buy bread that these may eat? And this he did, this he said to prove him, for he himself knew what he would do. Philip answered him, 200 penny worth of bread is not sufficient for them, that every one of them may take a little. One of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, saith unto him, There's a lad here which hath 5 barley loaves and 2 small fishes, but what are they among so many? And Jesus said, Make the men sit down. Now there was much grass in the place, so the men sat down, in number about 5,000. And Jesus took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, he distributed to the disciples, and the disciples to them that which were set down, and likewise of the fishes as much as they would. When they were filled, he said unto his disciples, Gather up the fragments that remain, that nothing be lost. Therefore they gathered them together and filled 12 baskets with the fragments of the 5 barley loaves which remained over and above unto them that had eaten. Then those men, when they'd seen the miracle that Jesus did, said, This is of a truth that prophet that should come into the world." Save the leftover. This is the story of the... everybody calls it the feeding of the 5,000. I don't like to call it that. I like to call it the feeding of the multitude. And this is not the only time that Jesus fed a multitude. He did this a couple of times. But this account of the feeding of the multitude in John chapter 6, this miracle is the only miracle that's recorded by all of the gospel writers, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And all of them record this miracle. They all have a kind of a different view of it. But I like John chapter 6. I like John's account of this miracle. And you'll find out why in just a minute. But it's the only recorded miracle that's recorded by all of them. And I think it's one of the greatest miracles in all of the Bible. And I think that God put it in all four because of this. Have you ever found yourself in a difficult situation? I know I have. And you didn't know exactly what to do? I've been there. How many times I've experienced this myself? And I've seen God's hand work in difficult times. And so we're going to go. This is going to be a short message tonight. I know you'll like that. And maybe get home, watch the football game. I think the Falcons won today, didn't they? I'm not on their bandwagon yet. I'm just kind of, you know. I'm a Packers man. I told you that, but they have a bye week. They're not playing this week, but anyway, save the leftovers. And so, number one, I want you to see. Consider the problem in this story. Consider the problem. There's a multitude here, and many of them are following Jesus really for the wrong reason. The Bible says that many of them are following me because they've seen what Jesus can do. They've seen his miracles, and they want to see a miracle. That's kind of like people today. They want to see something. And there's folks coming and going, and they're really not saved. They're really not with it. They're just kind of following Jesus. Maybe they're curious, And a lot of times in our church, that's what happens. Folks come and folks go, and maybe they expect more than we give them. Maybe they're looking for a miracle that they don't get. Maybe they're looking for something else they don't get. But listen, they come and go because mainly they're following the Lord for the wrong reason. There's nothing going to discourage me from following the Lord and supporting His church. Bad times might get bad. You might get discouraged, but just keep on fighting, keep on going. And listen, God will have something for you if you just hang in there. Amen. And so some of them were following the Lord for the wrong reason. But there's a problem here, and it's not a little problem. Here it says that thousands of folks have come, and it's dinner time. It's a long way from the closest eating place. There's no McDonald's around. There's no Cracker Barrel. There's just nothing there. And they're following Jesus. And the Bible says that there's 5,000 men here, not counting the women and the children. If you kind of add it up, the Bible says there's 5,000 men. There might be 5,000 women. There might be 5,000 children in this crowd. How many is that? Some of you are awake. That's about 15,000 people. So it could be between 10 and 15,000 people. That's a lot of folks. And they're just following Jesus around because they see the miracles that He does. And so this great multitude is following the Lord. It's a big problem. And the problem simply is this. There's a demand for which there seems to be no apparent supply. There's a demand that there seems to be no apparent supply. And so we see in this story that all of these folks are there, and Jesus says, how are we going to feed all of these people? 5,000 men, 5,000 women, maybe 5,000 children. It's a big problem, isn't it? But I got news for you. There's no problem too big for the Lord Jesus Christ. Aren't you glad of that? When you get stuck in a problem, you get stuck in a situation, listen, there's nothing too big for God. Jeremiah was a man that believed this, that there's no problem too big for God. And Jeremiah 32:17 says, ah, Lord God, behold, thou hast made the heaven and the earth by thy great power and stretched out thy arm, and there is nothing too hard for thee. We need to remember that when we get into trouble. When we get a problem in our life, we need to remember that. Listen, God, there's nothing too hard for thee. In verse 27, it says, behold, I am the Lord, the God of all flesh. Is there anything too hard for me? No. And so Jesus himself confirmed this, that there's nothing, there's no problem too big for him. In Matthew chapter 19:26, it says, but Jesus beheld them and said unto them, with men this is impossible, but with God all things are possible. And so here's the problem. Jesus said, you see all these people? How are they going to eat? There's no McDonald's around. There's nothing to eat. How are we going to eat? It's a big problem. But listen, many times in our life, we're looking at what man can do instead of what God can do. And we'll see that in the rest of the story. That's what they did. They're looking around. What are we going to do? We don't have anything to eat. There's no McDonald's around here. We can't get them a happy meal. But listen, I want you to know, listen, when you have a problem in your life, we need to learn to love our problems. That's real easy to do, isn't it? No, it's not. It's not easy for us to love our problems, is it? What do? Man, we fret. I'm talking to me now. I fret. I worry. I pray. And man, what's going to be the solution to this problem? And learn to love our problems, for every problem that we go through in our life is an opportunity to trust the Lord. Okay, Lord. How are you going to get us out of this one? Okay, Lord, I love it. What are you going to do this time? I've backed myself up into a corner here, Lord, and there's nothing I can do. There's no human possibility for me to get out of this. There's not enough money that I can pay somebody to fix this problem. There's no human reasoning that I can come up with to solve this problem. Okay, Lord, I got this problem, but my problems are your problems, Lord, and I'm going to have to depend on you. And so when we're backed up into the corner with a problem, every problem is an opportunity to see what what God is going to do. And boy, he can do it, can't he? I've seen it happen in my life over and over and over and over. Where I just throw up my hands and say, okay, Lord, you're just going to have to work here. Okay, Lord, you're going to have to fix this thing. It was a big problem. But once the problem has been acknowledged, then we have to look at the possibilities in our lives. So here's the story. There's a multitude there. It's a big problem. A lot of people are hungry. And Jesus says, what are we going to do? And how are we going to feed all of these people? I like that because he turns to him and says, he says, when Jesus lifted up his eyes, he saw a great company. When shall we buy bread that they may eat? And this he said to prove him, for he himself knew what he was going to do. I like that. You see, we don't know what he's going to do. And we don't know sometimes what we're going to do. But he always knows what he's going to do. I like that. Don't you like that? He solved the problem before you ever got into the trouble. He knew what he's going to do before this crowd ever showed up. And so he turns to him and says, how are we going to feed these? Because I'm going to prove you. We're going to put you to the test. We're going to see what you're made of. And so Philip's thinking about this thing. He says, man, how are we going to feed all these people? And Philip's kind of the analytical kind of guy. And Philip's trying to figure it out himself, kind of like what we do when we get into trouble. He gets out his ad machine. Y'all don't know what that is because y'all are too young. How do you do it in your... Oh, you go... On your phone. You see, back in the old days, you had the ad... With the paper, you know? He's adding it up. Let's see, 15,000. And he checks the offering bag, I guess. And they got some money. He says, he checks the bag and says, okay, we got this much money. He's doing his gazentas. You know what the gazentas are? They don't know what I'm talking about that either. Jethro went to school. Jethro Bodine went to school, and they taught him his gazentas. Two goes into four. Four goes into eight. He was doing his ciphering, you know, because he went to school. And so Philip's doing his gazentas. And he gets to the bottom. He hits the total button. It don't add up. And Philip's going, man, this ain't going to add up. I thought I had this thing all figured out. We had all this money, 200 pennies worth of bread. And what he's talking about is a penny's worth of bread is a man's normal wages. It's a denarii, a man's normal wages for one day. He said if a man works 200 days and gave all that money and went to the store and bought a 200 penny worth of bread, it's still not enough to feed all these people. 14 goes into 28. He's ciphering, he's doing his gazenta, and it's not coming out. You ever do that with your budget? You do gazentas? Brother Don, do you do gazentas? And you go, man, it ain't adding up. How's this going to add up? Hey, listen, I've been there many times where I go, hey, I think I better hold my offering out this week because it's not adding up. I don't know. We better cut back on the eating out this month. We don't eat out. You know we don't. We eat out about once a month, you know. I take my wife to a nice place like Subway. And I'm so mad at Subway. She asked me before that. I said, will you stop and get a Subway? I said, I'm mad at Subway. You know, they used to have the $5 foot long. It's $6 now. They went up a dollar. I'm boycotting Subway. I can go to Wendy's and get the dollar hamburger. I mean, you know, I don't eat hamburgers anymore, but we better check this out because it's not adding up. But the Lord already knows what he's going to do. So, look at the possibilities. Philip's adding it up. He's going to, hey, look, the possibilities are not so good here. He's trying to figure this thing out. But Jesus already knows what he's going to do, and he did this to prove him, to test him. Jesus knew. He wanted to see, Philip, what are you made out of? I'm going to find you out. I'm going to check you out. Sometimes the Lord does that. He does that to me. I want to see how your faith is working. I want to see what kind of faith you have today. I know it doesn't add up. I know the gazintas don't work. I know the ciphering don't work. But I'm the God of all the ciphering. I'm the God of all the gazintas. You can just throw that ad machine down because it might not work. But I want you to know I can work. I can do all things, the Bible says. And listen, he knows what he's going to do. So the possibilities are bleak. The money's not there. And it's not adding up. Thank God Jesus knows what he's going to do. You see, Philip represents man's view. Because that's what we do. That's what I do. I'm the first to confess it. I'm the first one. If there's a worry wart in my family, my wife, and she don't worry about anything. But I do. I mean, I'm just a worry wart in the family. What are we going to do? What are we going to do? My wife's always agreed, just trust the Lord. God's going to bless. And that's just my nature. And I want to learn that no matter what problem there is, and the possibilities don't look very good, that he knows what he's going to do, and he's in control of it. I thought about this the other day. It says that he made everything, did he not? He slung the world into existence, did he not? He put us on this planet, did he not? He saved your soul, did he not? Listen, he created all things, the Bible says. If he created it all, don't you think he could control it all? He can. But the possibilities are, that's pretty slim pickings here. The offerings are down this week. We don't have very much money in the bag. What are we going to do? It's a mess. The problem, the possibility. Number three, notice the prospects. The prospects. Well, we have to admit that the prospects were dim, said Andrew. The only prospect we have is a little lad here. That's all we have. A little boy here. We have 5 barley loaves and 2 small fishes, but he's kind of cynical. He says, but what is that among so many? He says, what is that? I think he does it sarcastically. That's nothing. Lord, you're talking about 15,000 people. We don't have enough money. There's nothing over here. There's nothing over there. And the only prospect is this little kid and his lunch. But what is that? That's nothing. Hey, listen. Never discount the faith of a child. I thought about this the other day when I was teaching my college class. I hadn't thought about this in many years. Years ago, I had a family on my bus route. They lived in Southwood Apartments. I was pulling maybe 25 kids out in one apartment complex. I was ripping that thing up. I went in there for 15, 16 years. And I had this family. The kids were just the nicest, coolest kids. And their mom was a single mom. Their father had died. And she worked. She was doing her very best. I mean, the kids rode the bus every Sunday. They were so faithful. I love those little kids. You know, sometimes you have special families. You're not supposed to tell the kids that. But there's some special ones, you know. And they were one of my special families. And I was visiting them one Saturday. And I always had this philosophy that as I visited my bus route, if I ran across folks that they had a need, how you doing? Oh, Brother Marty, we're sick. And I always had the habit, what's wrong with you? And they'd tell me, I said, can I pray with you? Can I pray for you? And right there on my bus route, I'll do that. If they say to me, there's something going on, I'll stop and I'll pray with them. And so this family, I went up and knocked on the door on Saturday and invited them, said, boys and girls, I want y'all to come ride. There's 4 kids in the family. Y'all be sure to ride the bus. We're going to have a big day. And mom goes, Brother Marty, would you pray for us? I said, I sure will. What's going on? She said, Brother Martin, she said, my car died. The engine blew up. That old clunker sitting right out there. And she said, Brother Martin, you know I got a job and I have to drive about 10 miles to get my job. I don't know what I'm going to do. And the car broke down. And I told her, I said, man, I don't know what to do. I don't have any money to buy you a car. And she said, Brother Martin, I just want you to pray. Will you pray for us that something will happen this week and I can get the car and I can go to work? I said, well, okay, I guess I will, you know. I said, well, I think we will pray. And when I said that, the 4 kids were sitting there. And when I said, okay, I think we'll pray for you. And when I said that, the 4 kids dropped on their knees right there on the floor in the living room. And I'm standing there going, what's this all about? And so I said, okay, I got down on my knees too. And I said, Lord, I don't know where this car problem is going to get solved. I don't know how you're going to solve this. I don't know what's going to go on, Lord. And I don't have any answers. And Lord, would you provide them a car? Would you help them, Lord, some way? Lord, just bless this family because they're trying to do right. She's working and the kids are being faithful coming to church. And I don't know how this problem is going to get solved. And the prospects are kind of bleak, Lord. Would you do something? And I'll be honest with you, I didn't really have the faith to pray stuff like that. This was long when I was young. And all the kids said amen. And they stood up. That was Saturday. Sunday they rode the bus. Tuesday I got a phone call. It's her, Mama. She says, Brother Marty, she said, you won't believe this. And I thought in my heart, I probably wouldn't. And I probably didn't. She was so excited. She said, Brother Marty, she said, my cousin gave me a car. And she said, I just wanted to call you and tell you thank you for praying that we got the car. And you know what she did? She gave Brother Marty the credit for getting that car. I said, ma'am, it's not me. And then I thought about it. I thought about those kids that dropped down on their knee on the floor right there, even before I had the faith to do that. Those four little kids dropped down on their knees and started praying. They put me to shame. And I said, ma'am, I said, it wasn't me. It's your kids that did that. Your children are the one that prayed that car in. Because I'll be honest with you, I didn't have the faith to pray that car in for you. And I told her that. She said, Brother Marty, you helped. I said, I didn't do anything. It's them kids that did it. Oh, listen, don't ever discount the prayer in the ministry of a child. We had a family in our church years ago. I didn't know this. And the young man was a just faithful family in our church. And the young man came up to me one Sunday. And this little boy was in my children's church. I was in our junior church for 25 years. And this little boy was in my junior church then. And he came up to me and said, Brother Mark, he said, I've been meaning to tell you something. He said, you know my little boy, Josh? I said, yeah, I know Josh. She said, I didn't ask him to do this. But every Saturday night when he prays, he says, Lord, would you bless Brother Marty as he preaches Sunday morning and as he runs his bus route? Lord, would you bless him? And this has been going on for months. And then I never knew this and they never told me that. And that just stuck my heart. Oh, listen, it's not me. It's the faith of that little kid that was doing something. Boy, that encouraged my heart so much. Listen, if I don't have anybody praying for me, I want some kids to pray for me. Amen. Because, listen, before God, they're not perfect, no. But they've not been damaged by sin. And they've got this little faith of a child that they can ask God, oh, God, would you bless Brother Marty? I think God loves that, don't you? Amen. So here's this little boy. He's no prospect. And he says, all he's got is a little lunch. But what is that? And so, little boy got his lunch out. And he went over to him and said, hey, son, I don't know what's going on, but Jesus wants your lunch. And little boy, he took his lunch. Man, he's been starving to death. There's no McDonald's around. He hadn't had anything to eat. He's ready to go. Man, he's thinking about what his mama fixed him for lunch. He's got his lunch there, and he's thinking about that all day long. You know how little boys, when they get hungry, and boy, he wants to get in that lunch. He's just thinking about putting his choppers into that lunch, and they come up, and they want his lunch. So I got thinking about the little boy's lunch. Let's see what he's got. Oh, yeah. He's got 5 barley loaves. These barley loaves are a food that the Jews made. They're kind of like little rolls, like little biscuits. And I can imagine he thought about these 5 little biscuits. Man, you know, there's probably butter on about 3 of them. But Mom probably slipped in some strawberry jelly, like Smucker's. That's my favorite. On that last biscuit, when you go to Cracker Barrel, you know, we always save that last biscuit for the honey. Pour that honey on it or that Smucker's on there. He's had 5 barley loaves. Man, he was thinking about that. I'm going to get those barley loaves. Boy, that's exciting to me. Oh, yeah. And he had the 2 little fishes. Smoked. They would smoke these fishes and they would cook these fishes and then they'd preserve them. They smoked them and salted them, boy. And I can imagine he was just going to get that fish and just chomp on that thing and eat like a corn on the cob. He's got those fish on his heart. He's thinking about the fish. And let's see what else he had. Oh, yeah, he had his drink with him. Got to get the blue raspberry Kool-Aid in there. He's got that. You got to have this. Got his pack of Twinkies in there. I mean, listen, he's got a lunch. Anybody like Twinkies? You like Twinkies? There you go. I knew Nathan would go for that. Man, you got to have the Twinkies in there. He's got his barley loaves and his fish and his drinks and his favorite dessert, his Twinkies, and Jesus wants to take it away from him. I got to think about this a little bit. wondering if Jesus wants to take my lunch. You see, Jesus doesn't want your lunch. He wants your life. Amen. That's what he wants. But this represented a big thing to this child. It was a big thing. I can imagine this miracle. He gave that lunch to Jesus. The Bible says they took it, and they break it, and he passed it out, and he fed all those 10 or 15,000 pieces of people. And I can imagine that little boy standing over there kind of watching this. Man, he's saying, man, this is cool. Jesus took my lunch. He's probably talking to his buddies. Hey, guys, did you see that? Did you see what happened right there? That lunch that Jesus passed out, that was my lunch. And I mean, he's probably going to say, man, whoo, did you see that? Jesus took my lunch. And Jesus broke it and blessed it and gave it out. That was my lunch. Now, I know we're not supposed to be proud, but isn't it a wonderful thing when God takes something that you've given, or God takes something that you do, and God takes something that you serve him in, and God blesses it, he breaks it, and he passes it out, and you say, man, look what happened. Look what happened on my bus route. Look what happened in my Sunday school class. Look what happened when I helped those folks along the way. And man, doesn't that feel good? That was my money. That was my time. I'm not saying be proud about it. I'm just saying it's a blessing when you see God do something with the things that you have and what you serve him in your daily life. And that little boy, he punched out his chest and said, man, did you see that? That was my lust. Whew, man. The Bible never says anything else about this little boy. Doesn't say his name. Doesn't say where he goes. He probably got in on a little bit of the barley loaves and fishes, but it never says anything else about him. Man, what a great grandpa story when he gets old. Sitting around with the grandkids. Fellas, I want to tell you something happened to me when I was a little boy. I was out there following Jesus with a multitude, and this man came up to me and wanted my lunch. And I gave my lunch to Jesus, and Jesus performed this miracle with it and passed it out and fed 10 or 15,000 people. What a great grandpa story. Kind of like what you tell the grandkids, you know. But this one's the truth. Yeah, think about that little boy's lunch. He doesn't want your lunch. He wants your life. And I started thinking about how the little boy could have reacted when they wanted his lunch. So, let's see what he could have said. He could have said, no, Jesus, you want my lunch? You don't understand, Jesus. This is my favorite lunch. My mama packed this thing for me, 5 loaves and 2 small fishes, and got my drink and my Twinkie in there. And Jesus, I'm hungry. So if you think that I'm going to give this lunch to you, you're crazy. He could have said that. He could have said, man, my stomach is hurting all day. I've been waiting to eat this lunch, and I'm just starving to death. So, you know what, Jesus? I don't think I'm going to give you my lunch. I think I'm just going to keep it for myself. Sometimes that's how we react to what Jesus wants to do in our lives. No, Lord. You want this? You don't understand, Lord. My kids need this money. You don't understand, Lord. I've got other things that I've got to do with my time. You expect me to do that with my time? I can't do that with my time, Lord. I'm not going to get saved. Right? I'm not going to get saved, no. I just refuse it. He could have said that. He could have said, wait a minute, Jesus. I tell you what, you asking for my lunch? I tell you what, let's wait a little bit. Let's don't do it today. Tomorrow my mom will pack another lunch. And in fact, tomorrow maybe mom will pack me 2 lunches and I'll bring you extra barley loaves and extra fish. And let's don't do it today. Let's wait. That's kind of what some people do today too. Lord wants you to do something. Wait a minute, Lord, let's don't push this issue now. I remember when I first got saved, folks said, they said, Marty's done got religion. He's done gone off the deep end. And I told my mom and dad, I said, we're going to church on Sunday morning and Sunday night and Wednesday night. They said, don't you think you need to wait and see how this thing kind of pans out? No. I didn't want to wait. Some people say, well, let's wait a little bit, Lord. You're going a little bit too fast here. Marty, you're going a little bit too fast. This church thing, it's not, you need to wait. I'm glad I didn't wait, Brother Charlie. I'm glad I said, you know what, Lord, if you want my life, I'm just going to give it to you. I'm not going to wait. He could have said that. Little boy could have said, hey, I'll tell you what. I'll give you part of what I have. Okay, Jesus, you can have the fish, but those barley loaves, I'm going to keep that for myself. I'm not going to let you have that. I'm going to give you part of what I have. And that's some people do that sometimes in their life. Okay, Lord, this area's in my life I'm going to keep for myself. God speaks to you and says, I've got something I want. You've got something you need to give up. You've got something in your life that's in the way between me and you, and you want to hold on to it, and you say, wait a minute, that's mine. I want to hold on to that. I'm going to keep that part. Amen. That's what we do sometimes. I'm glad, though, that when they came to that little boy and they said, can we have your lunch? He said, yes. Yes, Lord, yes. Whatever you want in my life, you got it. Hey, Jesus, you want my lunch? Here it is. You know what? That little boy, he didn't have the capacity to think about the future. But that's what we do. Now, wait a minute, Lord. This is what we do. If I give you this lunch, I won't have anything to eat the rest of the day. He didn't think about that. Lord, if I give you my lunch, my stomach's going to be growling for the next 3 hours, and it's a long way back to town, back to home, you know. And if I give you this lunch now, I won't have anything to eat the rest of the day. He didn't plan that out, did he? He didn't think about it. He didn't hesitate. He said yes. Here you go, Lord. You can have my lunch. Listen, Jesus doesn't want your lunch. He wants our life. Is God speaking to you about something? Why don't you say, okay, yes, Lord. Is God moving you to do something? Just say, okay, Lord, you can have it. Don't try to figure it out. Don't try to do the gazintas and the ciphering. Just have faith and say, okay, Lord, I'll just give it to you. And you're going to have to fix the rest of it. You're going to have to give me my lunch or something down the road. But I'm going to let you have it. I'm going to let you work it out. You're talking about exciting life.
Amen. That's good.
When you do that, that's exciting. And you step back and say, okay, I gave my lunch. All right, Lord, it's up to you. Feed me today. It's up to you, Lord, to supply my need today. Here it is, Lord. It's up to you now. And boy, watch God work in your life. It's exciting to serve God and let Him bless your life. Even in the leftovers. Let's all stand and pray. Father, thank you for tonight. I pray you bless us. And Lord, thank you for this little story of this little boy and his lunch. And the leftovers. And maybe, Lord, there's someone here tonight that needs to give up their lunch. Maybe there's something in their life they just want to say, Lord, okay, I'm going to do what you say or give up what it is, Lord, and not try to figure it out. Lord, I